So recording has started once again. I want to repeat that this call is being recorded and we will place the recording on our YouTube channel. If you don't want to be recorded, you may want to drop off now. And once again, thank you for joining for Azure Power Lunch. Julian, please introduce yourself. Floor is yours.
So thank you. Hello, everybody. Yeah, today I have the pleasure to present you some, I would say, community tool in regards to Azure Governance. It's called AZGovvis, or the long name would be Azure Governance Visualizer. And I want to showcase this thing to you today. So, who am I? My name is Julian Hayward. I'm a customer engineer. Primarily known as PFE, so Premier Field Engineer. We have a new role name. I'm based in Germany. I've been with Microsoft for 2.5 years now, a bit more. And my technical focus is on Azure, Azure infrastructure, automation, and of course, governance. So let me introduce a bit the problem statement around governance. Governance itself can be a quite complex topic. It's very difficult to get an holistic overview on your governance implementation if you think about all the capabilities that come into place. So for example, policies, role assignments, how do we connect the dots there? How do we really get an holistic idea or understanding of the governance, how it is implemented in our tenant, for example? So, with this intro on the problem statement, I would like to dive into the AZGovvis tool itself. So what is it? The tool itself is based on PowerShell. The script iterates your Azure tenants management group hierarchy down until the subscription level, not further down. We only have a holistic, governance view from the management groups down to the subscriptions. Whilst we iterate through the management groups and the subscriptions, we capture a lot of information in regards to those governance capabilities that are applied so far, which would be Azure policy, anything that goes in regards to airbag blueprints, for example, and a lot more, as you will see in the demo. From the collected data, we create three main information areas. The first one is a hierarchy map. So to really get a visual understanding of how is your management group hierarchy structured, how is it built up? Then secondly, we create a tenant summary. So all the capabilities, however they come together, play together, are gonna be summarized from the tenant's point of view, I would say. And then the third one is a granular scope insight on the management groups itself or even on the subscriptions. The technical requirements for the script are really minimal. You just need a couple of commandlets installed and the permissions, minimal. Well, a reader is still a reader, right? But we don't have huge effort to implement the required permissions. Good. So what does it do? On the left side, I tried to showcase all the data that the script is intended to collect. So here we are talking, of course, about the management groups, about the subscriptions, policy definitions, their assignments, as well as policy compliance. We are capturing all the RBAC definitions as well as their assignments. Same goes for blueprint definitions and their assignments. The script also takes care about limits, so Azure Resource Manager limits. For example, you have certain limits in regards to how many role assignments you can do per scope, etc. We summarize also the count of the resource groups. We take a deeper look onto the resource types that you have deployed within holistically within the tenant, but also then granular within the subscriptions or within a certain scope of management group. We take a look at the resource providers about the state. Also, a topic goes in regards to monitoring. So as we are grabbing the resource types, we're also going to have a look at the diagnostics for those resource types. So resource diagnostics, if those are capable for diagnostics. And there are also some security best practices, which will be checked. The outputs that thing then creates is first, it's a CSV file. So you have the data that you can just use raw. The second and the most interesting that we will deep dive today is an HTML file, which shall help us to connect all the dots, get a better understanding of the implementation itself, and yeah, therefore provide you with this granular reporting on the management groups as well as the subscriptions. And third is optional, or well, it works very nice, is that we also provide an Azure DevOps pipeline with which you then can create a markdown file output and even publish that within a wiki as code into your Azure DevOps and also have a visual overview of your hierarchy then. Good. There are some scenarios. So the requirements for any scenario that we are playing would always be that we need to have some AZ modules installed. Yeah, those are only three. So the accounts, resources, and resource graph. And on top, the required permissions would be that we need to have reader access on the certain management group scope that we want to read. So optimal would be, of course, we put it directly on the tenant root, then we can read our whole tenant. You can run the script, of course, locally from any console that supports PowerShell. You can use PowerShell 5 or PowerShell Core or even our latest builds. And there's this secondary scenario where you run the script within an Azure DevOps pipeline. Here we have some additional requirements. Our service connection, so that service principle there requires some additional API permissions, not some, but certain API permissions, which would speak against the Azure Active Directory API. We would need to grant our application read all access to directories. In regards to environments, the script itself is designed to support all the Azure clouds that we have in place, so the public cloud or Azure cloud, Azure US Gov, China cloud, etc. However, I have only verified working for the Azure cloud by now. So if you have a customer into any of the other clouds and want to test this, looking forward to get your feedback. Good, then we have some features. We have a user-friendly visualization of the entire governance implementation. There's also a demo, we will check it out in a minute. We have some parameters that we can run. I think it would be good if we go into the example now, because else you will not really, it will not really make sense for you, all these parameters here. So I will switch the presentation a second.
Quick question, Julian. Does it support, I mean, does it tell you about the limits on the resources as well? Like, for example, how many storage accounts you have, and that's how the maximum you can have.
No, not on a resource level, but let me dive into that.
Okay, yes.
Go so ahead. Sharing is good?
Yes, sir. I can see.
Yeah. Okay.
If right. You don't mind, so, can you increase the maybe the size? Thank you, sir.
Good. So this is the first output we get. If you recall, I've talked about the three different information stages that we have. So this is the hierarchy tree that it builds you. In my case, I've built a weird tenant here with a lot of, strange setup or whatever I have seen. By the way, all the IDs here, they are scrubbed or randomized. So all the subscription IDs, object IDs, etc., they are just random numbers here. And it will then show you your hierarchy, right, to better get a better understanding what you're onto and how it is built up. So the blue parts, of course, they reflect the management group. It shows the hierarchy down. So below this management group 9, we have another management group as well as one subscription is linked there. Good. So that's some nice information. It's just for the eye. A second information that kicks in now would be that we have a look at the tenant summary. So I will hide the hierarchy for a second. And it summarizes what's going on in our tenant. So we can have a view on, for example, custom policies, which are available in our tenant. We can open that up. It gives us information about the policy display name, the definition ID, the policy effect that it has, the role definitions that the policy deploys in case it is a deploy if not exist. It shows us how many unique assignments we have for this, and it shows us if this policy is used within a policy set. It will also show us orphaned custom policies. So during your tests, etc., you will build a lot of policies, and in the end, yeah, you should clean them up at one day. So all these orphaned policies here mean that those policies are flying around. They don't have an assignment, and they are not used within any other policy set or policy initiative. And then you can get some details and start your cleanup jobs. Yeah, it does the same then for custom policy sets within your tenant and also in regards to the orphaned custom policy sets. So here it means that the policy set is not assigned anywhere. It also gives us insights about if we are using some or have created policy sets that are using deprecated built-in policies. So you might have created a policy set a while ago. You've used a policy, a built-in policy, which meanwhile has been deprecated. So it's good to know that, so that you can take action and remove it, because deprecation happens for a good reason, of course. Second, it will show you all the policy assignments that use deprecated built-in policies. And then we will have an overall information about all the policies, policy assignments that we have in place. And now this is getting a bit more interesting. So we have the information about the scope. So are we talking about management groups or are we talking about subscriptions? We can filter this here. Yeah, let's go, for example, that I only want to see the stuff that this is policy assignments that go to a subscription. I can then, yeah, I don't know, filter down to whatever I want. I only want to see where there's no exclusion, for example. And then I want to know about, is it a policy or a policy set? Which category has my policy that is assigned there? Which effect does it come up with? What about the policy compliance for that assignment on that certain scope that we are checking now? And then again, the information in regards to does this policy assignment also do a role assignment? So in case we have a deploy if not exist, we are also deploying roles, right? And this gives you the information that we have here with this policy. We've deployed a role, a log analytics contributor, and here's also the assignment ID, the role assignment ID then for that role. Yeah, and last but not least, the information about the assignment ID itself. Good. Then we it gives you information about the custom roles that you have available within your tenant. Not that spectacular, but a good information also about orphaned custom roles. So no assignments in this case, orphaned role assignments. There are many different scenarios why you can end up with an orphaned role assignment. However, this will help you find those role assignments so that you can start your cleanup activities, of course. Then it also gives you the overall insights on the role assignments that you have within your tenant. And here it goes a bit like for the policy assignments. You can filter it by scope, by the management groups, by the subscriptions. Once you are at the scope, you can check if the assignment was at a certain scope or if it was inherited, for example, from the root or whatever. It tells you about the role, tells you if the role is a custom role or not. In this case here, it shows you where it is assigned to whatever. The modus how AZGoffers run in this mode was here that we do not show user information. So I scrubbed the user information here. It shows anything in regards to the object where the role assignment was done. It gives us information about the object type. Maybe there's some, some of you might be interested to see, normally a guidance should be that we have an owner assignment and it should not be for a user, or it should not be that often for a user. So this one here will find all the role assignments that go that assign an owner to an identity type of user, and then you can have a checkup if that really makes sense, if that was really meant to be that way. Likely you would check that up on the management groups, but creativity is free, whatever you want to test here. Good, then have a further look in regards to custom roles where, so this would give you the information if you have any custom roles in place that apply owner permissions, which should not be the case based on the best practices that the company proposes. It gives you information about all the owner permission assignments to service principals, which of course can make sense in certain scenarios, but well, you should have an eye on that. It gives you information for owner as well as for user access administrator permissions that are assigned to not groups, so to identities directly or to service principles. This is moreover to have a more holistic understanding what's going on. Good, then we go to the next session. Section gives you information about all the blueprints that you have available in your tenant. It shows you the scope or the ID, which you can read the scope. It shows you all the assignments that we have in place, and then again also shows you all the orphaned blueprints which have no assignment at all. Then we have a summary on the management groups itself and the information about the depth that we have implemented here. So I've touched the limit here, no further than 6 levels of depth. And on top, it then shows you if we are approaching any limits. And the limits that it is watching is based on the parameter, on an input parameter where we defined 80% should be our hard limit so that we get warnings. And we can see that for management groups, we are not approaching any limits here, for example, for policy assignments or for policies that are scoped within a certain scope, policy set scope or role assignments. It gives you then the information about all the subscriptions that you have in your tenant. The IDs, the state, the quota ID tags that you have listed there, as well as the full path. So in regards to the management group path down to the subscription. In case, there are also these quota ID subscriptions out there, AAD underscore, or maybe you have some pay-as-you-go subscriptions that you do not really want to check, we can also exclude certain quota IDs from our query, and we would then have a list of subscriptions which were out of scope by definition, or for example, those AAD underscore quota ID subscriptions. Good, then we will have an overview of the resource types that are available there in your tenant. So in my case, this is, I have 32 different resource types. In total, I have more than 1,000 resources. They are spread over 5 locations. And this is how it showcases to you. So I don't know, we could say, give me the resources that have the highest count. So you see, I like network security groups. Most of them are deployed in West Europe. We can filter that down again, and then it gives us, you have an idea or get better information what you really have in place. Or imagine an outage or something that you need to know, whoa, in this location, what do we have there? How critical is the situation, etc. Good. Then we also take a look at the resource types that we found and which of those resource types support resource diagnostics, right? So they are capable for diagnostics, so you can configure them to forward, for example, logs or metrics to an event hub or to log analytics or storage account. And this gives you the summary here. So for example, let's take a look at automation accounts. So you can see in total I have 21. Diagnostics capable overall, yes. It supports metrics, yes. It supports logs, yes. And if it supports logs, which categories does it support? And here are the certain categories that it supports. So this should help you to identify high resource count or critical resources where you really should have an eye on to check if you would want to set up diagnostics policies or whatever to make sure that you get this monitoring or logging in place. There's also some ideas to extend this feature here to really read what policies do we already have in place, and if they deploy logs, do they have all the categories in place, etc. Good. Then it gives you insights about the resource provider activation within our tenant. So in total, we have 189 resource providers, which are, where the total is 189, and then we have a number of 166 which are registered or registering, and in total we have 23 which are not registered. And then you can filter this down here by the provider itself. So let's, for example, check for CDN. It gives you then the overview that you have 8 subscriptions where this provider is registered, 0 where it is registering, we have 8 where it is not registered, and 0 where it is not unregistering. So recall, we have 16 subscriptions, so this makes sense. 8 are registered, 8 are not registered. That might help you if you have want to have a look that certain resource providers must be enabled or yeah, should not be enabled, whatever is your scenario in this case. And then we can go down detailed into the resource providers and then really check at the scope or check for a certain subscription. Let's go here, I don't know, again, let's check for CDN, and I go for a certain subscription, and then I can get the state for that subscription, for example, yeah? Or I can ask at a certain management group and then get all the subscriptions there. Let's do that. I have two subscriptions within that management group, and then you would get the information about it. Good. Then again, we are talking about limits, and as we are at the subscription scope, it takes gives you some more information in regards to, are we approaching any limits for resource groups? Are we approaching limits for tags on subscription? That is for subscription. Here we have something, well, this was on purpose, of course, I prepared it for the demo. We have more than 80% of the allowed policy assignments, and then it gives us the information, hey, it's this subscription with that subscription ID where we are approaching the limit. So we are above 80% because we have only an allowance of 100 policy assignments per scope. And it summarizes us how these 84 assignments come together. So 83 of those are pure policy assignments, whilst one is a policy set or a policy initiative assignment. You can then measure, take action, or say, I don't know, I higher the limit or I lower the limit, whatever you want to do. Good. Then we have this, and else we do not run into any issues here. Now we have a second view. And this is where we go into the details. Oh, I'm sorry. I will hide the summary. So this is then really where we get this granular reporting that I've been speaking about. So I'd like to check out, for example. So here are our management groups, of course, like we've seen in the hierarchy tree, right? So this shows us also how we are structured. We can open it up and then gives us information about this prod zero management group. Whoa, where are we? We can highlight us, here we are. So it's that prod thing there. Gives us information about the management group itself, the name, the ID, the path. It shows us how many policy assignments we have on that management groups, tells us how many of those assignments are at scope, how many are inherited. How many of those use built-in and or how many of those use custom policies? We can open that up. And again, we have our filter view and we can, again, filter it down to whatever we want to have. It does the same then for the policy set assignments that you have there. It gives you an indication about the limit, how you are about to approach the limit there. It gives you information about how many policies you have scoped within that management group. Same for policy sets, same for blueprints. And then again, also shows you all the role assignments that we have within this scope. Gives you a short summary. So 18 in total are inherited. 8 go on a user, 0 go on a group, 16 on a service principal. Orphaned are 0. We don't have any, so this must be highlighted better. But this is, indicates if you have a custom role that would deploy an owner, or if there are any role assignments that assign owner permission to a service principal. It shows us role assignments that are related to a policy assignment. Remember, deploy if not exist policies can deploy role assignments. It would show us if that was the case. And again, shows us the limit. So at management groups, we have another limit than at subscription. Here we have 500. We can again open it up and then filter around whatever we need to do. I would like to show you something as a different one. But whilst we are still at that scope, it also tells us, we have seen that here. So this is the prod. We've seen there's one subscription, right? And it also shows us that we have a subscription linked, and then we do that deep dive into the subscription again. There's some additional information for subscription, but it also gives us the state of the subscription, the quota ID, the Azure Security Center Secure Score. Again, the information about the resource providers, like we have seen for the summary. Yeah, tell us if we are approaching the limit for resource groups in that subscription, same it would do for tags if there was a tag. Gives you the information about the resource types and the resource types if they are diagnostics capable, as I've shown you in the summary. Again, then for policy assignments, for policy set assignments, and then on the assignment limits. Shows you about the scoping like it did in the management group. And then again for blueprints. Now it also, of course, shows of us if we have blueprints assigned, if we have blueprints scoped, and then in regards to the role assignments. I would close that and just check another management group to better get a better idea on the role assignments. So here, for example, here we would have one contributor assignment, which was indeed created by a policy assignment. So that gives you a better idea about, well, where does it come from? There's a service principle behind it. Who has created it? So you can easily indicate in this case it was a policy. For all the built-in policies, it would then also give you a link where you get detailed information about the policy itself, right? So that you can deep dive into it and inspect it. Next step would be to also give you more information about custom policies and custom roles. Good.
Hey, Julian, quick time check, man. We have 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And, just want to make sure that, just keep you, just so you know how much time you have left.
So, yeah. Go ahead. Okay, great. So I will go back to the presentation. I guess that the demo was done so far.
So one suggestion kind of came up. I was chatting with my colleague Alan, and he mentioned, like, have you plans to make it available on Azure Marketplace or something like that, where people can kind of connect to it and use it that way, or especially with Azure Monitor.
There are a lot of ideas how you could make it available more broad or as a service. The problem is, of course, with trust, right? You have this access to the tenant, I mean, it gives you a lot of information, right? We're also speaking about this on one of the other slides. But may I just complete the slides here and then we go into
question? Yeah, please. Go ahead.
Good. So, it gives you some information. So everything we have seen now also comes with some features where we can say, hey, create me the hierarchy map only. So only the first part that we have seen. You can define the limit warnings percentage, as we have seen. We can scrub user information. So as you have seen, that sheet would be very detailed and give you a lot of information, especially around owner permission assignments, etc. You could read the identities from there. So we also have the option to scrub this user information. We can whitelist subscriptions by quota ID. So for example, show me only those subscriptions that have a quota ID of enterprise agreement, for example, to exclude, for example, the pay-as-you-go versions. We can target a specific management group to create the record, the report. We have an HMM file and embedded version check. That is more a little feature. We have those filterable tables that I've shown you, and there's also an Azure pipeline YAML directly in the repository of this product that you can immediately use and create your Azure DevOps VKS Code pipeline. Granularity, I think you've seen that now. I don't think we need to go through the slide here. So the details level, you have seen it in the demo. What I need to say again, I guess it should be clear for everybody, but the confidentiality of the information here. So the information is really detailed, a bad-habited guy or whoever gets this output could read a lot of information, personal data from there, whom to approach to get access to whatever. So really make sure that these outputs are protected from non-authorized access. And then, of course, your contribution is absolutely welcome. Any input that you have, ideas or even technical contribution, feel free to do so. There are two repositories at that time. The first one is my repository directly. So there's always the latest version, and we also have it in the CAF, so in the Cloud Adoption Framework repository, where there might be some minor version differences by now. And then also my hint, if you are into Azure Governance policies, RBAC, etc., you might also want to check out AZ Advertiser. So thanks a lot for having me here, giving me the time to speak about it. If we have enough time, I will take the time, ask your questions. Let's have a discussion. Thank you.
Any questions, folks? I know we are over time, so please feel free to ask and unmute and ask any questions.
Questions, I think this is a great tool, great visibility.
No, I think definitely, it provides a lot of useful details. So Julian, I thank you for your time, man. I really appreciate it. Thanks for taking time to presenting. And folks, everyone, I will share the video and the slide deck on our YouTube channel so you can download it and watch it on demand. Thank you for joining. And I hope everyone have a wonderful weekend. Thank you very much.